Now we're finally ready to talk about derivative, which is definitely one of the big ideas in this course. What is derivative? Well, we've already seen it in the previous section. It's instantaneous rate of change at x equals a. But I also would like to talk a little bit about background or a little bit of history of calculus and how it came about. And the word derivative is different from economics that you may have seen it, but it definitely implies instantaneous rate of change at x equals a, or at a point, which is defined. We've already seen a difference quotient like this, limit as h goes to 0 of f of a plus h minus f of a over h. In more geometrical representation, it's also described by tangent line, which is basically a line that touches at a point. And we're gonna use the words like tangent and secant, which are come from trigonometry, which is actually thousands of years old. But the meaning of it is very similar, actually. The word tangent is derived from Latin tangere, which is a verb from to touch. So a tangent line usually touches the curve at a point. We'll see the geometrical, actually the drawing next. And this is what it looks like. Here is a point. So the tangent line is basically going in the direction of where the function is going next, in the positive direction. So it looks like it will be increasing or growing. And the slope is a very simple idea with lines to see how much something is increasing or how fast something is increasing. Whereas with any function may not be as simple, which is why we use the idea of a line, or we keep going back to the idea of a slope. So the tangent of a line of the graph of y equals f of x at a point of a, f of a, is the line through this point having the slope, which is defined as limit as h goes to 0. Well, we've seen this already. And provided that this limit exists, if the limit does not exist, then there is no tangent at the point. So the derivative is not always defined. So the derivative is also instantaneous rate of change, or if it's at a point, it's a slope of a tangent line or a number. Now here is the main difference quotient. Note how we use x as opposed to a. There is a slight difference here, but the whole idea is the same. It's f of x plus h minus f of x over h. And what it represents is already some of the concepts that we've seen. First of all, it represents slope of a different term. We're going to use the term secant line, which means to cut. And secant line cuts through the function at two points, which is very much the average rate of change or average velocity, as we've seen already. So notice how there is no limit. There is no limitation as how close or apart these two points are. Basically represent the average. Now, derivative itself is same idea, this difference quotient, but with a limit attached to it. So these two points must be very close, or as close as they can get, to each other, which is what represents by limit as h goes to 0. So derivative represents the slope of tangent line at a point. It also represents instantaneous rate of change, instantaneous velocity, for example, or we've seen the word marginal cost, revenue, or profit already, or how much those functions are increasing. There's different notation historically that we can use it. Now, calculus is not as old as algebra or trigonometry or geometry, for example. It's only about 200-300 years old, since sort of beginning of 18th century, I believe. 1700s is when it was first discovered. Actually, it was discovered, it was a little bit controversial through the history. Like nowadays, the companies fight with patent wars and so on over who discovered what and who gets credit for what. It was similar with the discovery of calculus. Actually, Newton was believed to have discovered calculus first, but it turns out that Leibniz, which is a German mathematician at the time, discovered it a few years later, and this is actually Leibniz notation that comes from like f prime of x, or y prime. We pronounce this a prime. It's not an exponent, it's actually a prime, like an apostrophe. So we credit this notation to him. He made his discovery known, and Newton, I believe, thought that he stole his ideas from him. And there was a whole war. There's a book called Calculus Wars. If you want to check that out on Amazon, it's very interesting, like the history behind the whole discovery and how it came about. But anyway, there was definite need for calculus and instantaneous rates of change. But here is some of the notation that we'll see throughout the course. F prime of x, this is the most common one. Y prime, dy over dx, this is more like the slope notation, change of y over change in x, or df over dx, or c prime of 5. This is a marginal cost at x equals 5. A lot of times we'll find something called derivative function. Not quite the slope of the tangent line yet until we plug in a point. So we can do that as opposed to calculating it at each point separately, which can be quite tedious. So for next few examples, we'll take a look at, we'll come back and take a look at the graphs maybe a little bit later, but I want to look at calculating the actual, these examples, which are, you can see on the ebook and my math app, by the way. Basically, when I looked at the slope of the tangent line, the negative 2 and 2 was already given. The other point you may have to approximate or look closely, maybe if one of the points falls right on the integer values. So I estimated it and then I computed the slope. Some of the slope of the tangent line may be quite obvious, like 0 for the horizontal line or undefined for vertical. So actually where slope is vertical, that's where the derivative would be undefined. That we'll see that later. Now let's take a look at computation. It's a little bit different, but also similar to what we've done last time. Notice how what we would like to do in this problem is, using definition of derivative, find derivative function f prime of x, then use it to compute at three different points, f prime of negative 2, f prime of 0, or f prime of 3. So there is definite advantage of finding the derivative function first and then plugging in different points to find the slope of tangent line at those points, rather than having to recalculate the whole limit definition with each one of them. So notice how we do it with a function. It's actually very similar, sort of like similar in section 2.1. We plug in x plus h for the x. Notice how we expand this out. We get x squared plus 2xh plus h squared for the first term, and then distribute the 9 plus 9x plus 9h plus 2. And then what I have done is take the whole top of the derivative quotient, f of x plus h minus f of x. Rewrite the whole thing. There's nothing combining here, unlike with the numbers, but you can still write it. Then minus the original function. Notice how I put it in parentheses. We can distribute the negative, and then note that everything that doesn't have an h in it is going to go. Pretty much the original function is gone. So what we have remaining is 2xh plus h squared plus 9h. Only three terms remain. Now you can either divide it by h ahead of time, then plug it in, or you can plug it in, then divide by h. Either way is fine. I'm plugging it in back into the limit. And notice how I write it over h. So we found the top portion already, f of x plus h minus f of x. This is what remains. So I basically divided everything by h. Notice how we have 2x left plus one of the h's, then plus 9. And then the idea is the same. Whatever remains, now we can plug in h equals 0. Notice how as soon as I plug it in, we don't have a limit already. We evaluate it. And so the remaining function is 2x plus 9. And that's our derivative function. And now that you have it, now you can plug in f prime of negative 2, for example. Plug it in into 2x plus 9. We'll get negative 4 plus 9, which is 5. Same thing with 0, we get 9. And same thing with 3, we get 15. So that's kind of the idea. Now let's try it with a rational function, 12 over x, which is a little different, although it's a similar idea. We have difference quotient. Notice the first one is easier to do. Let me scroll down a little bit more. We basically plug in x plus h for the denominator. The harder part is probably subtracting the f of x plus h minus f of x. which is 12 over x plus h minus 12 over x. This is where most algebra would come in. And now note how I brought it to common denominator, which is their product. So I sort of like cross multiplying, we'll get 12x minus 12 times x plus h. And now notice how distributing the 12, notice how 12x would cancel. So we end up with negative 12h on the top, which negative can come out. And I kept it as x plus h times x in denominator. I didn't distribute the x, although it's fine if you do distribute it. Next, I actually divided by h first, so I complete the whole difference quotient. Note how I write the top divided by h, which is the same thing as the function, times 1 over h. So dividing by h is the same thing as multiplying by 1 over h. Now notice how the h on the top and h on the bottom are gone, so we end up with negative 12 over x plus h times x. Now we can finally plug it into the limit. There should really be parentheses around there. So let me see if I can quickly add them. So it should be the limit of negative 12 of x plus h times x. Now limit as h equals to 0. Again, I'm plugging it in for the only remaining h in denominator. And so we're going to end up with x times x, basically, which is x squared. So that's how we end up with a negative 12 over x squared. So that's the derivative function. Again, we can plug in negative 2, so we'll get negative 12 over negative 2 squared, which is negative 3. Now 0, on the other hand, the function would not be defined because you have 0 in denominator, or does not exist, like in my MATLAB, as often mentioned. And same thing with a 3, we'll get negative 12 over 3 squared, which is, if we reduce it, that's negative 12 over 9, which is negative 4 over 3. So you may want to practice with these couple a few times on the homework, practicing with different functions, because it takes a little bit of practice with these. And then later in next chapter, chapter 4 actually, we'll learn the shortcut rules, which will help you compute it quite a bit faster. But it's good to go back to the roots, how it was originally defined with the limit, to understand where it's coming from. Now we're gonna, for the rest of the section, we'll talk about where the derivative is not defined. Well, first of all, the function has to be continuous. That's like the first condition that has to be satisfied. Derivative is not defined typically at a point of discontinuity, any point, whether it's a whole, a vertical asymptote at a point, or jump discontinuity. Now, if the function is continuous, we have the verb called differentiable. Not all continuous functions are differentiable. There are some examples that are not. Basically means the function may be continuous, but derivative is not always defined. If a tangent line is vertical at a point, then slope of tangent line is not defined. That's sort of obvious, going back to a slope of a vertical line. So this usually happens at the so-called cusp points or sharp points. They look really sharp where the slope gets really steep. Here is one example. Notice how the corner right here is sharp. I even drew this like kind of a dotted slope of tangent line, or tangent line actually, which looks vertical. And notice how at that point, that cusp point right here where my cursor is, the derivative is not defined. You can also visualize graph of absolute value function where the corner is very sharp too, so you cannot find derivative at that point. But notice here we can have the second example. We can have a nice smooth continuous function, but here is the point which is also called the point of greatest growth, or we'll see the point of diminishing returns. That's going to be one definition later, where the function is growing and then it starts slowing down again. So here it looks like slope of tangent line. Here it actually cuts through the function, but it still looks vertical and it's still not defined. So anytime it looks sharp like this, or anytime it looks like it's the greatest growth, that's where the derivative is not defined. So there's few examples in the homework where you have to look for either discontinuities or sharp points or points like this where it looks like it's gonna be vertical. Tangent line is going to be vertical. And the last example we'll look is the business application with a demand. What if it's given in terms of P, and P is in dollars? The idea is exactly the same to find the derivative, except we have P instead of X. Notice how we defined it. And again, we try to keep variables consistent. So again, I simply plug in P plus H into the function and you distribute it. It all works out exactly the same. And you get six terms at the end. If you're working this out correctly, you should actually take it on the side and try to work it out. Then I typically subtract the original function, same idea. We have terms that are left with P and H, negative 4PH minus 2H squared minus 4H. Then I plug it straight into the limit, divide by H. Then what's left, we can plug in H equals 0. Notice how we'll get negative 4P minus 4. So that's the derivative of the demand function. Now, find and interpret the rate of change of demand when the price is $10. Well, we can simply plug in P equals 10, so we'll get negative 44. What does that actually mean for us? Well, the demand is decreasing, because it's negative, at a rate of about 44 items for each increase in price of $1. Now, this only works on prices $10, so basically, if we switch from 10 to 11, we know this is how much demand would be decreasing. So the higher the price, the more demand decreases. Now, if you get too far away from price of $10, of course, it would be different. So we have to be fairly close. But this is what the decrease is approximately for each increase in price by $1. And that's it for this section.